In the last video, the top 10 Bleach moments to be animated in the final arc, I asked for a whole 1,000 likes. And you guys pulled up and said, nah mate, we're going to give you 3 times that and give you 3,000. So as promised, here's a top 10 fights in the Blood War arc. This was a surprisingly difficult video to make as I excluded those of which were in the moments video, and I try my best to base these from meaning and relevance to them in these fights and that the fanbase as a whole are anticipating the most in the soon to be anime. Yes, I know how much you guys are sweating and coming over Pepe Wakabrata, right? Or anything pertaining to him, but I don't know. I didn't quite have the space to put him in the list, boys. Sorry, not sorry. But before we get into the objectively correct list of fights, a word from our sponsor. There's some huge things coming towards this Bleach's 20th anniversary, and one of which is being the merchandising. Figurama have teamed up with the Bleach licensors to bring you this incredible, high extra detailed Vasta Lorda Ichiga and Segunda Etapa Okiura statue, and I have the privilege to help spread that word. You can have Ichigo Blastocera right in Okiura's face as he attempts to measly Lanzadel right in your room. And don't tell me this wouldn't look metal. Speaking of metal, Ichigo's sword is made of it, so you know that this is in fact the real deal. Little details such as the crescent moon and the cracking of the masks really show they paid attention to detail, with added flair of LED lighting. This will be a limited edition, with only 1,300 units being sold, and it's expected to sell out fast. So get yours now. If you wanted to see more of their amazing work, they also did a multi-award winning Devilman vs. Amon and fastest selling Eren vs. Armored Titan statues. So please click in the link in the description down below to sign up to the wishlist to be alerted when pre-orders are in fact open, which will be on the 25th of July, and be a part of Bleach's history. If you are in fact worrying about the cost, they do an awesome payment plan, and if you use my code JHBLEACH, you can get yourself $25 off the asking price. So let's show the industry how much the Bleach community is hungry for more Bleach merch and statues, and let's get this amazing product. So before we get into the stick of it, these fights I couldn't possibly rank from least to best fights. So for the majority of the part, there is no particular order, and it also helps prevent me from getting flamed in the comment section, if only a little. So let's get started. Ichigo versus Yuachi's first confrontation. This small one-sided fight had a lot to say for itself. We just finished off a fight with Ichigo versus Kurage and with the Soul Society in absolute disarray. It's only right that the lead up to seeing this exposition throw down is what makes this confrontation so intense. Byakuya is seemingly about to die, and Ichigo hears screams of help and despair from the middle of the Garganta, adding to a buildup of rage and despair. He leaves the Garganta with Kubo hiding Ichigo's face as he sees a defeated Rukia and Renji. Everyone in the Soul Society can sense him as he flashes into mid-air to a broken Byakuya as his spirit is fading. Bear in mind, even stern writers like Kangdu and Bambia seem shook by the malicious spiritual energy itself. Still, with no shot of Ichigo's rage-torn face, Kubo made Ichigo's entrance seem as if he was the last hope in the advantage of this invasion. To Yamamoto's death, there was a huge diminish in morale, and Ichigo was the light in that tunnel of darkness that had been succumbed. Even hearing something as uncharacteristic from Byakuya as asking Ichigo to save the Soul Society and even protect it, makes Ichigo, who was already holding back his rage from inside the Garganta, simply loses it. We see a rage, and it is demonstrated by Ichigo's speed to get to the scene of Yamamoto's mutilated body. His reaction then goes out of control, showing anger as he rushes towards Yuabach. While this isn't a fight as you'd expect, Yuachi parries and slams Ichigo's attempts to damage him, and even gets manhandled to the ground, as well as Ichigo's Bankai being split into two pieces. Even so, Ichigo still managed through rage alone, allows his spiritual pressure to reach Yuachi by damaging the clothing on his arm. It's impactful because Kubo gave us these amazing shots of Ichigo. He gave us something no villain was able to do for the storyline in such a small time. So to see how quickly the light dimmed through Ichigo gave the audience a sense of suspense, and of course loss. It's simply on the list because I believe this moment is anticipated because of its build-up alone. Orihara has always been an oddity when it came to teasing his capabilities to even the concept or idea of his Bankai. From telling Renji that he couldn't train Chad himself with his Bankai due to it not being suitable for training. Had the audience speculating for years what Kisuke meant by this quotation. From his intense knowledge of Kido and evaluating his opponents from a distance, there were times he stayed back on the sidelines to spectate his opponents before making contact. However, in this dire situation of the Stone Ritter, he was very much pushed into a corner that we had never seen before. After allowing Yoruichi to tackle Asuka head on first to gauge his ability, Yoruichi was able to cause an immense amount of pure destruction with her complete Shunko, Raijin Senkai. Though as time went on, the death dealing ultimately suspended her from proceeding by his poison and immunity to her attacks. Kubo definitely built up Asuka as a formidable opponent by using Kisuke's nature to observe before fighting. Ichigo and Yoruichi, joined by Yashiro, Yoruichi's brother, is yet still wasn't enough to put Asuka on the back foot. A truly formidable opponent that lives up to being a member of the Royal Guard. While Kisuke's evaluation was indeed to determine Asuka's abilities, he also managed to resolve the immediate danger of his abilities to Yoruichi, with which was a seemingly humorous nod to their past relationship. Yoruichi was able to use the ability of fickleness to constantly change her Ryatsu stability for 48 times per second, changing it faster than Asuka can get accustomed to, which prevents him from creating an immunity. However, the poison was already placed in the gift ball he had created and eventually lost the stamina to continue fighting. With Urahara being pushed to a bankai after a devastating blow to his vision, he was able to distract and incapacitate Asuka until his backup plan with Grimmjow had come into fruition. As Kisuke was single-handedly fighting while creating an opening in the gift ball for his escape with Yoruichi and Yashiro, unfortunately, Kisuke admitted that this was the worst case scenario and was a gamble as he wasn't confident on. He needed the work of Nell and Grimmjow to play in this part. Kisuke, however, didn't anticipate a suicidal attack after Grimmjow's final blow, and Nell's contribution to save all four was vital, more so to time they had to escape in such a small opening of space. Not only is this a must-see because of Yoruichi's thickness, and in fact for Kisuke's long-awaited Bankai, but because of how suspenseful it was. We finally saw a Kisuke who tops Mayuri, Aizen, and Senjimaru in intelligence have his back thrown against a seamlessly inescapable wall. Rukia vs. Aznot. There was a lot of poeticness in this fight. I mean, look, do people want to see this fight animated? Duh, dummy, of course. Seeing Rukia flex a Bankai for the first time is definitely going to be one for the history books that will cement in people's memories for years to come. Being invested into Rukia for such a long time gives us this payoff. But before we talk about this fundamental surface level of the fight that is 99% will fanboy over, I would like to come out and say the hidden layers in this fight is what truly makes this more impactful. Rukia has always been burdened with this mindset of being accepted by Byakuya and wanting that. It's somewhat fundamental to her biggest weakness. Having Byakuya allow a position to be a seated officer just after the Fullbring arc gave her more confidence in her abilities, but having Byakuya face such a horrific defeat also shown to us a more merciless side of Rukia, which we as the audience wanted to see. This was a personal fight, and being able to avenge her brother who she seeks validation from also lets her breach that barrier for some much needed character progression, which in fact happens to be the main theme of the Thousand Year Blood War arc. After seeing the training with the Zero Division and Renji's result of that against Master Masculine, it was time to see Rukia finally shine. While Renji was more so of a cocky, cool demeanor, Rukia was, unironically, cold. She had no fear anymore as Byakuya's acknowledgement was not an issue. She had the power and Aznot's ability just didn't work. In turn, Aznot's ability affected him because his fear was that his power wouldn't work, simply because at that moment in time Rukia was technically dead. As her absolute zero ability was decreasing in temperature, the cold demeanor is very fitting, and what we have here is fear. Fear versus the death, as Rukia is, in fact, death saves the strawberry. Nemaya versus the Elite for Sturmritters. I chose Nemaya versus the Elite realistically for pure flashy reasons. This was the creator of the Zanpakuto, a guy that usually has a goofy demeanor, switched to a completely serious persona in literal seconds. Though as a whole, Squad Zero gets a lot of flack for being weak from the community. However, wouldn't showing a threat level be prevalent by having them destroy the strongest squad in the Soul Society? Yeah, you could argue that they could put up more of a fight, but this is a war. Having a highly anticipated squad being hyped up for years only to be decimated shows how much the threat level the Quincy's were. Let us not also forget that Nemaya soloed 4 of these Quincy's single-handedly while other Soul Reapers struggled with the army before from the power absorbed from the remaining Quincy army in the Soul Society, something the likes of Kenpachi was able to accomplish with 3. However, these were not chosen personally by Uwatch himself. And if you still look at things, this was a 4-on-1 matchup. Kurinji, Hakafune, and Senjimaru were only observing from the sidelines until it was too late. Nomoya was able to adapt his situation with Asken, understanding his ability quite well in a timely manner, being able to make decisions only an experienced fighter would, like cutting his own jugular to release just the right amount of blood that would overflow his body, and having the synergy to cooperate with his allied squad to replenish and heal his wounds in a timely manner. Regardless of how it turned out, I understand both perspectives, but the pure flashiness of this battle will be such a spectacle for the upcoming anime. Ichigo vs. the Quincy's. With Ichigo vs. the Quincy's, it's quite the simple concept of Ichigo finishes coming back from the Soul Palace, Kubo displays how fast he is by showing the clock tower before and after he got there, saves Kenpachi and slaps all of them single-handedly. And while we love Ichigo literally flex on four opponents, I think the magic here is a nice callback from the Soul Society arc where Ichigo comes back after being away from training, but instead of saving Rukia, he saved Kenpachi, someone he once saw as an enemy. It's impactful because it symbolises or reminds you of how far the members of the Soul Society and Ichigo have come in terms of relationship, as well as Kenpachi and Ichigo's subtle rivalry. Kenpachi saved Ichigo against Tesla / Noritora, and Ichigo saves Kenpachi, repaying the debt, almost with their entrance and demeanour being the same, friendly manner. Symbolism aside, would I say this was a fight? I mean, sure, with Candice and Ichigo for the majority of it, Ichigo just speed blitzing and literally showing no effort in his swings or counters. This is heavily implied when Ichigo demonstrates a Getsuga Jujisho with the expectation that Candice would dodge because he wanted to fire a warning shot. Quite clearly, this was a warning shot that was too strong, and Ichigo yells for her to get out the way in fear of her ignorance would end her life. Seeing you watch appear, Ichigo runs full speed towards him, unfortunately 4-8 Quincy's get in his way to try and stop him. The moment in this is pure comedy. Kubo really wanted to showcase Ichigo's strength, and he did it in the most badass way possible. We had Meninas grind Ichigo's face into a tower building, and Ichigo just continued moving forward. Robert point blank aimed a gun at his face like he did with Shunsui Kyoriku, and Ichigo dodged it while still focusing on his goal of catching up to your watch. This man was not taking priority or care or even notice to these Quincy that he'd done so much collateral damage to the Serrote prior, and was eating full attacks without losing momentum, or in fact energy. Mayuri and Nemu versus Pranida. I never would have thought a fight with a literal f***ing hand would be one of the most weirdly yet beautifully written fights in the series. Now, I've always liked Mayuri, but his development alone in this fight is a video all and of its own. After Kenpachi almost gets turned into a literal meatball, Mayuri was able to determine and analyze his opponent quite quickly, managing to hold his own. I think the real treat that many fans love with Moira's character is his infatuation with unexpected scenarios and how he treats these events. While many characters would be hopeless or discouraged, Mayuri advocates these challenges, and from an audience's perception are in fact anticipation to see the reactions from Mayuri alone and his ability to counteract them. While Mayuri is often criticized for being overprepared and has a counter for everything, Mayuri, much like Urahara, plans for every possible scenario, though more so than Urahara. This helps us also understand the enemy with the analysis and ability explaining. While it's a very flashy fight in and of itself, as well as gruesome, we got to see the extent of Mayuri's Bankai that gives the audience a shudder. For example, going into detail about the sentient being born with 700 layers of nerves on the surface of the skin, that even the draft of air creates an excruciating pain for that being, really makes the audience imagine such scenario. Yeah, it's creepy. Mayuri for the majority of the part is very calm and collective against Pranida, and while Mayuri at one point was winning, Pranida was able to gain and adapt information from his opponents, leading Mayuri into a corner. This leads ultimately into Nemu saving Mayuri, as well as her demise. This has a huge development for Mayuri. In a somewhat emotionless yet somber ending, we felt Mayuri's pain, we understood why he treated Nemu the way he did, and for a moment we saw Mayuri for the first time face despair. Not to mention, this is the first time we really see Mayuri instead of standing back and fighting. He charges in head first and is the aggressor, which was very refreshing. But let's have another Mayuri fight, Mayuri versus Zombie Tashiro. I think this is generally a very underrated battle, mainly because it ended very quickly and wasn't too much to write home about. But for me, someone who was a fan of Tashiro versus Gin back in the Soul Society arc, we were told constantly about how Tashiro was a child prodigy, and how he mastered many different aspects of the Soul Reaper fighting styles. In the Soul Society, for me at least anyway, we seemed to lack the drive of agility from Tashiro and was given how Tashiro's emotions are his biggest weakness in battle. We were shown a tiny smidgen of Toshiro not holding back in his fight against Haribel as soon as he knew his injured comrades wouldn't be affected by his spiritual pressure, but it wasn't cutting the mustard for Toshiro fans. So why do I like this zombie form of Toshiro fighting Mayuri? Besides Mayuri being a savage towards his morally questionable drugs, Toshiro in his zombified form lacked that very specific weakness, being emotion. With this restriction removed, we saw an all-out, no-hold-barred Toshiro utilize not only swordsmanship, but in fact the unique ways he can use his ice abilities. Toshiro in this state shows not to give his enemies time to recuperate with double-tapping Ikkaku. Then, without hesitation, he finishes off Yumichika with not only a slash, but uses melee, before he could even call out to his Zanpakuto release. Mayuri's zombie fighter Ronkar approaches him and makes no hesitation to strike him down, only to then rush and attack Mayuri. Toshiro makes no time in giving the enemy an advantage and makes every blow one with killing instinct. Though his fight with Mayuri and his attacks getting parried by Mayuri's auto-aim Zanpakuto, yes, Mayuri has cheat codes on, Toshiro used melee attacks, to which when Mayuri blows off a part of his knee, he heals that said wound with ice, stopping the bleeding and firmer damage while simultaneously striking with his sword. Toshiro also shown his skill in battle by calling out his Bankai while holding his blade to freeze Mayuri, which was connected in a somewhat instant manner, while killing Mayuri as a result. This killer instinct is something Toshiro needed and shows without his mental drawback, he can showcase why he holds a current position as a captain. Shun Tui now versus Lele Barrow. Being a controversial fight during its time, Shun Tui's bout with Lele was very thought-provoking within its execution. I'm not going to talk about the mythological forms of Lele, that's a separate topic in and of itself, but what fascinates me the most during this fight was how you defeat an intangible being made from light. Shun Tui's Bankai was briefly stopped by Ukotoke within the fake Karakura Town battle, and it was stated that too many people would have been involved within its radius given a lot of suspense towards the capabilities that Shun Tui holds. Naturally, after witnessing this fight, it's clear to see why that is. Shun Tui bases his attacks from his enemy, or should I say anyone within this area of effect, manifesting from child games. This ability was one of the select few that would work against Lele, or as Kubo would lead you to believe. I'm briefly going to go over these abilities as there is still confusion to this day and something the upcoming anime may really make a lot more clear cut. So my interpretation may be, well, take it with a pinch of salt. The first Dan, affecting any damage made from anyone within the area sharing the same said damage, intangible or not. Second Dan, an incurable infection towards the parties involved that feels shame that they have been infected with such an ability or injury. A battle of mentality. Parties involved will fight in a submerged pool while their spiritual pressure is being drained, until only one with the last remaining Ryatsu is left standing. Though because Lele discourages this stage by repeatedly trying to escape this scene, as you were, we then move on to the final act. The final Dan allows the user to be granted the White Thread of Regret. Essentially, from my perspective, any way killing the actor that refuses to proceed with the scene and causing themselves suicide. Unfortunately, this didn't work for Lele and the gamble made by Shun Tui leaves him exhausted, essentially left for dead. It's a very poetic battle with many meanings and can be quite alienated to a Western audience. While Bankai aside, Kuroku's abilities displaying light speed reactions and travel, along with tactical strategies against his opponent, Shun Tui comes off the notion very quickly he doesn't have within his arsenal to defeat his opponent. So where does Nanao begin to come into this equation? Never being one for combat and even being left out on the receiving end of an Uesugi, the context lies within Shun Tui wanting to keep Nanao very close to him during his past. Though being extremely skilled in Kido and support, she has never really had to put herself in the front line, and the battle she used with her hidden Issei family Zanpakuto is very based on reality. Kubo really solidifies the fact that even the weapon itself is not fully usable if the user isn't of its capabilities to handle it, hence why we get a somewhat sweet moment with her and Shun Tui. Kenpachi's Bankai, Toshiro, Byakuya's tag team versus the Miracle. I don't think this would truly be a top fights list without Kenpachi having a moment somewhere. Now while I could use this whole segment to talk purely about his Bankai alone, I will in fact use this position to say 3,000 likes and I'll drop a top 10 Bankai list. Besides the audience just finally getting the reveal of Kenpachi's Bankai and seeing the pure destruction it causes, thankfully Kubo didn't write it without its flaws. There is a reason Byakuya stated that a Bankai needed 10 years to master. But back to the point. The fight doesn't actually start with Kenpachi, but instead the visors before Toshiro shows up to confront the giant, wasting no time to get into his Shota Bankai mode. Sadly, he doesn't seem to do much besides making some ice for the big boy to break, which enter stage right, Byakuya Kuchiki, though even though their combined height doesn't seem to intimidate their foe. Without wasting any time, the third member of the boy band arrives, Kenpachi, in his usual fashion by cleaving off the hand of the giant. The start of the fight is here. Kenpachi showcases the absolute monster he is by outmuscling someone whose height matches the walls of the Vandam Rake, then proceeds to slap him around for a bit as he has no care for the sheer size of his opponent. Though the ramifications of throwing a giant of that size isn't without its realisms. If Valkyrie was to fall on the Soul Society, he would have destroyed it, and that's the kind of caution and tension our team faced. So I generally really can't wait to see this animated. This fight really showcases the idea of an ultimately regeneration versus the ultimate aggression. And this is without mentioning Kenpachi literally beat Valkyrie's arm off. You know, an arm that's larger than, let's say, a couple few buildings casually? Go and scale that bite, power scalers. We get several surprises in this fight from seeing Kenpachi use Bankai and the realization that it is nowhere near max power, or the fact that Zoraki Kenpachi isn't strong enough to sustain his own Bankai. Not only do we get Kenpachi's Bankai, but Kuba decided to throw in a curveball with Toshiro. Turns out he isn't a Shota boy anymore. Oh yeah, and he can freeze all matter or something like that, you know, normal things we expect from a genius Captain Shinigami. I especially like this part of Toshiro. No fangirls, not because he turned hot, but because all this time Kubo giving us a mixed bag of emotions with the expectations of Toshiro's strength is finally awarded to the fans, and the math from the very early chapters stay consistent. That being said, though Byakuya was supposed to have died in early on in the war, Kubo gave Byakuya a nice supporting role with his fellow captains, with a new move that goes back even to the Soul Society. I think Ichigo assumed all of Byakuya's swords would attack him all at once, and whether Byakuya was taking that idea from Ichigo, or improving on mastering it, is a nice development nonetheless. And thus we see throughout a brilliant team fight with three completely unexpected personalities. Though in saying that, it is best we don't talk about the ending of that fight. Ichigo versus Uwatch. What can I say? It's the finale of Bleach, the final fight. And while our beloved protagonist gets his ass kicked and completely loses hope in the first round, Ichigo fought admirably, giving us an array of suspensive attacks and one fans have been yearning for, the Getiga Grand Ray Cero. Unfortunately, Uwatch countered it. From Ichigo's entrance to his fighting ability, Ichigo blasted a good fight. With his will and conviction to go against the idea of fate, Ichigo gives it everything before he can reach his realism that at that moment, he just couldn't win. And as a reader, it dropped our hearts. Turns out, running at a potentially out of us or being head-on wasn't such a good idea, which leads to a suspiciously familiar action of Ichigo being stabbed with his powers returning, or his sword being fixed in this case, by Tsukushima. Ichigo's Bankai was deemed to be so threatening that Uwatch decided that it was best to break it in the future. But this is where the real fight begins. A very likely team of Ichigo and Renji joined by the man who stood atop of the Soul Society, Aizen Sosuke. From the tricks of his illusions, to the intervention of an arrow in the dark, to finishing with a single slash, gives us a glimpse of what Ichigo's true ability really was. Ichigo seeing a falling Uwatch as he screams his fears makes this such a somber ending, yet understandable at the same time. This fight, truth be told, is short. Of course, we know the situation of Kubo at the time, so it's understandable, and perhaps, with the anime on the horizon, this short fight may be a bit more impactful within the show itself. But tell me what you guys think. I hope you enjoyed my list. I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fight to be handsome. And as always, people, peace out.